All right, let's recap the last session. Let me get some music real quick. I think Abby gave me privileges to share. Can you guys hear that? Cool. Yeah, I mean, last session, you all made it to Caliman, finally. Caliman, the large walled city, the beacon of the East. You saw the incredible massive statues of legendary heroes from the past, from thousands of years ago. And you all made it to the ports of Caliman, where kind of all the Voglins were scrambling to get their bearings, the people that needed to go and get healed up, you know, and go to the medical tents and stuff were taken there. And a bunch of other, like, kind of random crazy stuff happened. And kids fell in the water, I think, and you guys used the immovable rod along with Willow's strength to kind of...
Can you turn the music down slightly?
Yeah, it is very loud, isn't it?
Just a little bit. That's...
I don't know why it's so loud for me. Let me see. I have it, like, very low on the actual YouTube app. Is that still too loud?
I think it should be okay. Just maybe you speak loud.
Okay, yeah. Is it my mic? All right. But yeah, so you all made it to Caliman Ports, and you met all kinds of wacky characters, most notably Scrip, who is the head journalist of Scoop News, and he was kind of taken by your guys' stories, and he kind of helped you escape, right? He helped you escape. Here, I'll just pause the music. I'm not sure why YouTube is so loud. He let you all escape using his little birds. He told you about how the Bacaruses were lying, right, about being mayor and speaking for Vogler this very instant at a high council meeting. This is all the same day as Vogler's, you know, destruction. And yeah, so you all start running through the city, see all these crazy vendors. You get some coconuts from Coconut Chris, a fruit vendor who looks just like me, but with a giant... deserted island beard, and eventually you make it to the gardens where you're able to sneak into the royal hedge maze. And speaking of sneak, very luckily and awesomely, like, use your abilities, even your skill checks, just your random bullshit, your investigate, found a secret passage. It looked like it was, like, it belonged maybe to old, you know, children of the past of the royal family who had this cute little gate hidden into this hedge. And I kind of cut the way through straight out of the maze. There was a guard there, but Sneak was quickly able to knock him out with the punching bag arrows. And then you all impersonated guards, one of you with magic and the other dressed up. And I actually have a massive retcon, my friends, because I totally fucked up on something, but it's okay. Derek was with you all this whole time. But I totally forgot to have him in these scenes. So these are the quick retcons that I could think of, and you guys can definitely help me out, fill in the details if you want. But Derek, you know, nervously agrees to sneak through. Yeah, I mean, the last time I talked about Derek was him, like, about to pass out, and that's why you guys got coconuts at Coconut Chris's, and, like, we just fucking forgot about him after that. We're just like, just take a break, dude. You burned it. But no, he did go with you guys. I'm guessing he was kind of nervous. He didn't really want to break into Castle Caliman, especially as the newly knighted Knight of Salamnia. He's in his knight armor still, has the helmet and everything. So the way I imagine this is that he actually helped really sell the whole guard situation, because the guards might have even questioned you all less. They're like, oh God, there's a Knight of Salamnia with them. Yeah, just take these. But they might have been, like, a little shocked, like, oh my God, why is a Knight of Salamnia helping take these two lovebirds out? Because that was the alibi that Sneak and Lyx were sneaking about and in the hedge maze, I guess, doing who knows what. And you all are able to convince everyone, let you in, the guards. I think it was Bob the guard that Melvin was disguised as. Bob, whose body is somewhere in the hedge maze in boxers, and you all make it to the throne room, which is no longer used in the ways of royalty, but it is still used by the leaders for these high council meetings. But before you enter, you find Lord Bacaris the Younger kind of your guys's foe from Vogler, and you all decide to knock him out. So the way I imagine this is with Derrit as the retcon is I think he was also livid, and Willow, I like you initiating it, but I think Derrit maybe also like gives him a huge, just a big punch in the face, kind of adding to him getting knocked out in one hit. And maybe you guys even had to take Derek back to calm down because he was even angrier than all of you and really wanted to just beat the shit out of Lord Bakaris the Younger. How does that sound? Too dark? Or I think it kind of makes sense with where Derek's head is at. So yeah, you guys kind of calm him down. And I actually think with that situation being a little more intense, a little louder, maybe some of the High Council members actually are like, "Do you guys hear that?" Like someone actually said that. And then you guys come in. And try to do your whole thing. We come in peace, blah 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 blah. And I think at some we actually got to actually, sorry. So then you guys invade the High Council meeting. And let me actually share so that we all see, kind of get a refresher here. Let me play some music again. Man, this sounds loud in my headphones. I wonder if it's my headphones. Is it somehow softer? Okay, you guys hear it. Okay, wait, my tech assistant is trying to do something. What are you trying to do? Difficulties. But yeah, you guys can fill in if you want with the High Council meeting. What do you all remember? Or I can. I'm back online
I
here.
don't remember names of anybody, but I do remember one of the non-player, two of the non-players was this young, like upstart kind of guy who is like in charge of like I think commerce or something.
Yeah, basically trade.
And he seems kind of neutral, but maybe kind of leaning on our side based on what we said. And then there was the
Yeah, he's
other
Theriadis, so you can remember him with the whoop, Theriadis, whoop, Theriadis.
Okay.
Yeah, he's the sleazy, kind of sleazy younger elf, all kinds of ornamentation and gold, and yeah, even gold fangs.
And then there was the I don't remember, I don't think she was older, but just the fighter who
Oh,
happens to
yeah.
be blind,
Yep.
believed all of us except for Melvin had a role
And
globally,
retcon
so.
and Derrit, I rolled for him.
Okay.
So Melvin and Derrit are nervous. And I think that also makes perfect sense,
Well,
especially with
because we're trying
Derrit.
to hide magic. We're not trying to hide that we're lying. We're just leaving
Yeah.
stuff out.
Yeah.
That's still more than half the party that she believes, so I think that's all right for now, hopefully. And that's what I remember because I don't have my own player character because that's a lot for me.
There you go. Yeah, but
I
basically it was a meeting to decide the fate of Vogler, right? Lord Bakaris is pretending to be mayor. But yeah, go ahead, jump in, Colton. What were you gonna add?
was gonna say also, I remember there was lots of talks of like just with the High Council and them being in, and I remember Thaddeus because I played him a little bit, he being really upset about everything that was happening, and I remember he was forget his name, but he was trying to say, "Oh, we're the yeah, I'm the mayor," and he's like, "No," and then yeah, but yeah, that's what I remember.
Yeah, pretty much it was. I mean, yeah, there was a lot of angry people, kind of everyone trying to squeeze in just their own thing, really, and not talking too much about Vogler or even you guys, the Bronze Bombers. really the only ones who kept bringing you guys back into the conversation was Lord Bakaris, who thinks you guys should be arrested immediately for attacking his son, invading the castle, breaking into the High Council meeting. And the governor, right? The governor who's kind of so far has come off as pretty serious, pretty stern. This guy right here on screen, Governor Miat, he's kind of agreeing with Lord Bakaris. And so far, he doesn't even really think that Bakaris is not mayor, and just sees you all as breaking in to his meeting. Yep, and then Willow, you were right. This is Marshal Nestra. She's actually the supreme leader of the entire military of Caliman. So pretty important position and person. And we'll get to her in a second because she's actually exactly where we left off. And yeah, and then there's our good friend Alastrius from our early sessions. Now you guys get to see where he actually, you know, one of his positions of power that he has in this great city, basically overseeing the art and culture and historical movements of the city. And he actually works along somewhat closely with this other council member, Onyx. I don't know, Lyx, if you want to jump in on Onyx, but Onyx so far kind of presenting herself as a little political, right? A little political, trying to both sidesy things so far. Really wants to talk about, you know, fortifying and defending and building more, and the masons always being the foundation.
Yeah, basically what you said, but she doesn't have like a proud family. She was kind of like self-made in some ways. And so she thinks that she's really in touch with the people. And she's like, I don't know, like Nancy Pelosi or something. But she's very far removed from reality.
Yeah, so, and yeah, and we're actually going to have a lot more chance to let these characters speak, if you so wish. And then we have Colton's crazy High Council member, Thaddeus Timberjaw Blackwater. Also seemingly serious and stern, but maybe with a little more anger, a little more racism, maybe. immediately assuming that the bronze bombers are refugees breaking into the High Council meeting and just saying, oh, these refugees are fucking up my docks and my ports and things are getting so much harder. You guys suck.
The picture of him is AI. Like, I just, like, typed in like angry dude standing at a dock with a beard.
Oh, perfect. Honestly, that looks like what I would imagine Caliman as, honestly. That's great. No, that is him in my head. And then we have Maester Elmentias, I think. The public health guy. Bit eccentric. A bit weird, a bit lost, talking about shit and flies and stuff. anything I'm missing, Melvin? Is that pretty much it? And Melvin's like, or Errol's like, yeah. Cool. So yeah, I mean, and oh, and I forgot to say this, but we can be on roll 20 if you all wish. Yeah, and I added you all to the scene. So this scene is pretty hectic. I wanted to have some hectic music, but for some reason music is not on my side tonight. Maybe I can troubleshoot with it later. Yeah, I don't know, Sneak, if you want to have any background suspense music or... I'll set up a scene while you do that. So yeah, you guys are all in this really cool throne room. It looks like there's a lot of like things that have been removed, as you can see from these weird like wooden things. Like maybe there was statues here or paintings or something of the sort, and it's all kind of removed, giving the impression that it was obviously taken somewhere else. There's a giant table in the middle. You guys are all kind of actually above everybody, almost like if you're standing on a large platform up here. There's some kind of stairs that head down there. It's not too visible in the picture, but yeah, so we left off on Marshal Nestra asking you all a very important question, and I'm including Derrit in this question too. She looks at you all as everyone's talking about what to do about Vogler and about to do what to do with all of you, and basically asks you a simple question: should we retaliate and retake Vogler, or focus on defending Calaman? And everyone kind of grows silent to that, looking at you all to hear what you have to say.
This is a difficult decision. I know the Delings, we want to go home. The only place we've ever known is in the forest and in the woods. And they would break our hearts if we never returned there. So ultimately, I want to say I want to go. However, do I need to go now? I don't know.
Melvin sort of thinks about it for a moment. And putting his hand on Sneak's shoulder, says, "Remember, friend, home is not where you live, but who cares when you're gone? They'll follow you wherever you go. And here, Vogler is gone. There's really no two ways about it, as far as I can tell. We saw Kinsoldi completely wipe everything out. Even if we could retake it somehow, the cost would be too great, and we'd be fighting over what? The burned and scorched and rotted land? I don't know."
Right. We should rebuild and fortify grounds and then just rebuild and make new homes later. We should probably fight, that's for sure. Though it hurts me. Sneak chuckles at the end.
Yeah, so Lyx, you keep thinking of Vogler's destruction over and over, and you're kind of zoning out, maybe it looks like from your chat in Roll 20.
Yeah, kind of seeing the have either been natives of Vogler or were just there longer than her have kind of seemingly said what they're going to say. Will is just going to pipe up that I've been all over the map. I've been to big towns, small towns. Vogler was the first place that even remotely started to feel like home. That being said, what we would be going up against is larger than anything you can imagine. Like I said, I stopped counting after 100 dragons. I know Calaman is a great defensive city and they have a large army, but even with all of that, it wouldn't reclaim Vogler, and there is not much left to reclaim at the moment. I'm not saying Vogler is gone forever, but this is not the time, and they're coming to Calaman. You send the resources there to Vogler, Calaman will also fall. I can promise you that. Our only shot is fortifying here and hoping that we can go back one day.
And then Elastrius kind of looks at you all and says, Is Vogler truly gone, as you all say? Is it truly just ashes?
What's done, it's in the past, it's ashes.
Yeah, and Derek kind of nods his head solemnly as well. And like, yeah, there's kind of some murmurs between the High Council now hearing all this that, you know, they've been debating this Vogler thing and not really realizing that Vogler itself is pretty much gone. I feel like Theriadis is like, "I'm sorry for your losses, but I still think we got what it takes here to take them on. We should." And then Lord Bracaris kind of jumps in and says, "Yes, I will lead the charge again. As I've said, I don't care how many dragons they have. I will lead this fight." And then Marshal Nestra kind of finally jumps in and says, "You idiots. Didn't you hear what they said? Not only is there nothing to reclaim right now, but Kinsaldi, the general of this Red Dragon army, told them to tell us everything. There's only one reason she would do that. So that we move our resources over there, leaving Calaman less defended than normal, and then they strike and take our city." And then there's kind of like a silence.
"By all means, Lord Bacaris, you can head over, but I would highly recommend Calaman send him alone. It would be a net win for everyone."
Yeah, and then Lord Bacaris is like, "This is preposterous. Why are we listening to them still? They should be in handcuffs. They have my son." And like Lord Bacaris the Younger is just kind of like knocked out on the ground, I'm imagining. Yeah, Theriadis is kind of chuckling, and the governor's kind of nodding his head too in disbelief. And then the governor looks at Darrett and says, "You, Knight, you wear the Knight of Salamnia armor. Who knighted you? How long have you been with the Knights? Can you speak any truth to this? And then Derrit's like, I was knighted by Sir Becklin, Uthvaharan of the Order of the Crown. I was knighted today. And then you actually see the governor kind of like restrain a chuckle. And even Elastrius too, and Theriatus. Oh, no way! And how do your High Council members react to this Knight of Salamnia that has been knighted today and he's asking for honesty?
Thaddeus just scoffs. Like, doesn't just so disgusted. Like,
Elementos is like.
Yeah, even Marshal Nestra kind of has a smirk. Yeah, and that I think Theriatus is honestly like laughing, maybe hysterically, like hitting the table. And he's like, sorry, he just, I thought he was like, you know, gonna be the one, like, oh, we gotta listen to this guy, you know.
In fairness, he's been training with her since he was a child. He's only been knighted today, but he's a pretty good fighter. I can vouch for that.
And then Elastrius.
He earned it.
Yeah, Elastrius catches himself and says, yes, he was trained by Sir Ispin Greenshield and Becklin Uthbaharan. And the governor like kind of is taken aback by that, and Marshal Nestra is as well, very visibly. And she's like, oh, okay, that is interesting. That's good to know. Perhaps you have some skill then, boy. She's like, well, I still sense that you all aren't telling us the full picture. This is your last chance. What are you keeping from us? And I know that you, Melvin, and Derrit are especially hiding something. And you can imagine dramatic music playing now.
Can I try to roll a deception? Another deception?
No, we're going to keep the one that you had. This is all the same scene, same sequence.
Why do you question our credentials, yet not Lord Bakaris's?
She says, yeah, she looks at you and says, I know he's lying out of his teeth. He's a very obvious liar. He lies in every which way that benefits him. But right now, that's not important to Vogler or to the situation with you all. And then Lord Bakaris is like, what? How dare you? And he's like kind of like pouting and like.
Fine. If you must know, I have been gifted some of the Tide Stone power.
And then the governor looks at you and like very, very seriously. And Elastrius is kind of like tapping his hand on the table, like a little nervously and trying not to make eye contact with you guys.
But it wasn't the Tide that saved us. It was the ingenuity of one of the fellow Voglins. He built a device that we were able to use to learn information about the soldiers. And we were able to steal a tank. They had a freaking crazy tank that we stole. So we're not really keeping much secrets from you all. It's just that, yes, I can do a little something.
The Tide is a serious power. And for it to awaken naturally in someone is a big deal. It takes years and years for our red robes and white robes to master anything related to the Tide. And many of them die along the way.
Yet red robes? White robes?
And then, again, you kind of hear scoffs around the table and, like, groans and, like, oh. And then Governor Miat looks at you, Melvin, and says, if you want a history lesson, perhaps Elastrius can come to you in your prison cell. And then he says, all right, enough with these bronze bombers. Marshal Nestra, I am charging them with trespassing of the capital territory, trespassing into High Council meeting of extreme importance, attacking a nobleman's son, and stealing the armor of our city watch.
Governor, please.
Silence.
What would you do for your city?
I would do everything for this city. And that's why I represent this city, and that's why I was voted into this position.
We had someone in our midst that tried to usurp power while our town was destroyed, and we came because we knew that he was trying to usurp power.
I've heard from Lord Bakaris is that he's willing to fight for Vogler. You all invade my castle. I mean, the castle of the people.
My city was destroyed. My home was destroyed. We don't just go out on a limb for this. We mean this. This is true. If you want to take us, dude, literally, go out to the docks and ask anybody that this fool ain't nothing.
Marshall, I've had enough of this. Please accept the charges now. And then Marshal Nestor looks at you all and says, I accept these charges, Governor. And now I drop them. As Marshal and Supreme Leader of the military, their crimes are forgiven. Bronze Bombers, please wait outside the throne room as we discuss and vote on the proposals made tonight. And actually, before that happens, Alastair just kind of jumps in, and the governor's looking furious, like you know, he can't get a hold of Marshal Nestra. Lord Bracarys is also, like, bamboozled. And Alastair's like, wait, before we vote on anything, we must talk about the Voglin refugees, right? They can't just stay in the port. Marshal, I really appreciate you forgiving the Bronze Bombers. I know they're holding back a bit. And Marshal Nestor looks back at all of you and says, yep, I know that you all, you guys think we don't know who you all are? You don't think Alastrius has told us of all your exploits? You all have fought back hundreds of ghouls in Mount Kowumba protecting Lord Alastrius. You channeled the tide. You befriended a dragon, a bronze dragon, and flew on his back. You thwarted a supposed death knight named Lord Soth. And now the city of Calaman has the Morning Flame Orb, thanks to your efforts. Yet you keep this all from us. That's the only hesitation I have with you Bronze Bombers. You keep hiding something. But it's okay. I know your intentions are true. And then, like, everyone's kind of taken aback, kind of remembering, like, these stories. And Alastrius looks at you all kind of nervously, like, well, sorry, I mean, you didn't tell me not to tell everyone. I had to tell them of my heroes. I paid you well, you know. And the governor kind of is shaking his head. He's like, Alastrius, please get on with your proposal. This is already going long enough.
I was going to say, Sneak would probably read out, like, you know, our agendas are our own, but we are good. Like, we do mean well. It's not that we're trying to hide anything. We just don't think to tell.
My lord, we should hear them out. I want to hear what this Alastrius joke would propose that we do with the Voglin refugees.
And Alastrius is like, first of all, ouch, maester. I've been here for a long time. I'm shocked to hear you talk about me like that. But sure. Well, it's simple, really. I am proposing, and it comes with a bit of a heavy heart, but I'm willing to do this. The fact that the Bronze Bombers are once again here fighting for their people, being heroes, and making a truly epic scene worthy of a painting of art. This is art spewing out of their soul, passion and love for their people and themselves and each other, has inspired me. And I, Alastrius Etholish Vute, say that I will open the Vute Mansion to not just the Voglin refugees, but as many refugees as can fit. I no longer need to live in that place. I can find something else, I'm sure. It's an old heirloom, yes, legacy, and you can hear, like, by the way, this, you know, shocks and, like, and especially Theriadus, he had his, like, legs on the table, and all of a sudden his legs are off the table. He's leaning into the table, looking intensely at Alastrius in total shock. He's like, I can find something else. It's too big for one guy. I don't need all that stuff, really. I'm offering to give the mansion away and let it be a public housing for these refugees.
And, public housing for sickness and death to fester?
Well, not if you do a good job, Maester, right?
Well, I never. My methods are perfectly sound.
And this would be a great grounds for you to prove that, right, Maester Elementoise? And then he kind of, like, pats your back. Elementoise. Sorry.
Even Thaddeus must say, if we're fortifying our grounds, it's nice to at least have a little bit more hands on the deck, or at least in the area to help fortify this area.
Exactly. And Mr. Thaddeus, I know you care about where the money goes. This is free of charge from me. Just you, no compensation needed. This is just a goodwill that I will give. Maybe, I don't know, we can name the house after me, I guess, but it's already named after my family, so I don't really care.
Yeah, whatever.
And Onyx, you might like this. I'm also proposing that we do put some funds into finally rebuilding and, building up the infrastructure of the southern ring of Caliman, turning the slums into something a little more livable, and Onyx, you can be there at the ribbon cutting, and you can help lead that charge. I'm sure that would look great for your re-election.
Oh, that is incredible. Yes, I love that idea. Thank you, illustrious. And furthermore, I will certainly be at that ribbon cutting.
I'm sure you will, my dear. Well, that's it. Really, just giving away my mansion at the Gate Lake. I mean, sorry, the Anastasia Lake community. And yes, and maybe throwing some funds toward the lower rings of Calaman, and actually giving more housing so that people don't have to live in tents anymore. Yeah, so this is definitely a moment for maybe some of the High Council to react, but real quick, as you think about your High Council, Thaddeus kind of jumps in and says, "Illustrious buddy, wow, what a proposal there! Now that's a good heart you got there. I'm all for everything you said, pretty much. But I could, I've been eyeing your mansion, a little bit myself, and I wouldn't mind taking it off your hands. And as a good deal, I'll give you a good money, right? I'll give you all the money up front, and half of the mansion could go toward some kind of refugee thing. Or actually, I will definitely vote yes on the lower housing thing. How about that? I keep the mansion though. So he's trying to swindle the mansion out of Elastrius's hands, and Elastrius is like, oh. Well,
Can we beat
he's
him
kind of,
up?
you want to try, bud? Do you say that out loud?
Yeah, 100%.
I don't think you want to try that with me.
Dude,
And
don't be a swindler,
Elastrius,
dude. Swipe or no swiping, dog. Come on.
dude, Elastrius kind of
okay.
looks at
Willow's gonna
you.
step in and kind of like quiet sneak.
Yeah, Elastrius looks at
He's
you and
had a
just kind of
rough
like
day.
saying like, yeah, Elastrius is making a very strong signal to like, don't talk to him like that. I
Whatever,
don't know
dude.
if I don't think. Actually, sneak, I'll give you your moment here. Do a fear check. And it's at advantage, right? Because Kendra don't get scared. Yeah, does anyone want to jump in? Any high council members right now
There
or
yet,
PCs?
if it's a property you seek, my masons can build you something rather quickly.
It's just he's got a really nice place, you've seen it. It's
Yeah.
across the lake from mine. It'd be really nice to just have that, I get to see I see his mansion every day that I go home, and it's pretty big. It's bigger than mine, but he's earned it, of course. I'm just a little shocked that he's willing to give it away like that. That's not how I do things. Were you able to roll something? Yeah, so just roll twice.
All right, we'll just roll D20 twice.
I'm
Yeah,
going to
that's weird that it
is.
doesn't. It didn't tell me shit. Yeah, it didn't tell
Oh.
me nothing.
Why did it
11 and some.
combine them?
Well, 11 or 7, so I'll go 11.
You're not scared, but thanks to Willow's kind of stepping in, you're like, huh, okay, maybe I should stop.
I'll just
You're
shut up,
definitely not, you're
yeah.
not scared. You're not scared of him at all.
But just see, it's not the right plan.
So, Aomantios, you were gonna jump in?
As you can see by our small friend here, these refugees may prove dangerous, but they may have their uses, as Timberjaw states. I say we should put them to work. They claim to have skills. We will let them. And then, let's say half of their earnings shall come to the council. Onyx, would you agree?
And then Governor actually jumps in. Hold up. We cannot talk details with these ruffians still here. So the proposals are, actually, he looks at Marshal Nestra. Marshal, are you satisfied with what the Bronze Bombers have provided? Can we kick them out? We'll let them back in once we make our decision. Unless you have anything else you want to hear from them. And this is the Bronze Bombers' final chance to talk about anything related to Vogler, themselves, housing.
Yes, we are refugees from Vogler, and we were a much smaller city. Obviously, your great city has much more resources, but many of us were very specialized and would be more than willing to pull their own weight. We are simply asking for a safe place to stay while we try to figure out what to go, what to do. None of this we really could plan for. And we are more than willing to pull in our fair share.
And I actually worked at Lord Vute's residence. I was the kitchen staff for a brief period. So the only thing I'd like to say is that I'm familiar with the space and we could be self-sufficient there. There are gardens in the backyard. We could harvest some of our foods there. And it might actually be a really good space for us.
Yeah, and Illustrious is like, yeah, Lyx was the best cook. Yes, amazing cook. Such memorable dishes she prepared. Yes. And then, like, you can see Marshal Nestra, she's kind of like leaning against the wall again, head down, and you could kind of see a smirk. But everyone else doesn't really care.
I was going to say, Sneak even mentions, he's like, hey, we may not seem like much, and the Bronze Bombers may not seem like they have some solid leader, but the fact is that each of us pull the leader card exactly when we need to do it, and we all follow exactly when we need to do it. We're a good team. You can believe in us.
And then Theriadus is like, I like them. Let's keep them. But the mansion, please. And then Illustrious is like, I think not, my friend. Sorry. And then Theriadus kind of like collapses on the table, like sad. He's like, let's just get to voting.
Well, if I may speak, once the Voglins have solid housing elsewhere, in theory, the mansion could be up again, depending on what Lord Etherish wants to do with it.
Now, that's what I like to hear, and he perks up right away. He's like, see, now that's a negotiator right there. All right, I am Team Vogler and Team Bronze Bombers. Let's get to voting. And you can kind of hear some groans from some of the council members. Anything else before the Bronze Bombers have to leave? And then, all right, so the governor says, you all will wait outside until we call you back in. Marshal Nestra will know if you try to leave the premises. In that case, you will certainly be arrested. And then Marshal Nestra looks at you and she says, yeah, that time I'll actually not believe you guys. I'll have reason to doubt you all if you run away from this. And then Lord Bakaris kind of like runs up and says, get your hands off my son. And like kind of grabs him and picks him up. Does anyone do anything?
I want to point out, he was just on the floor. Like, we no longer have, like, physical...
Okay.
Like, we're not physically holding him. He's just been passed out on the floor.
Sure. I feel like he's a bitch enough to, like, he still says that, even though you're not, you don't have your hands on him.
Oh, for sure.
He's like, don't touch my son again, you scoundrels. And he's, like, mumbling kind of something under his breath about the marshal and, like, very angry and just can't believe what's going on. All right, are you all walking out? It looks like some people don't. Maybe that's funny on the roll 20. Cool. So the governor kind of like, y'all leave. The governor sighs. All right, this is going on much longer than I anticipated. It sounds like we've already made our decision on whether we should retaliate with Vogler, but I'll still propose it officially. Regarding retaliation attack on Vogler, can we agree to a unanimous yay to fortify Calaman and not attack Vogler? We'll start with Onyx. Yay or nay?
I second that motion. Yay.
All right. Motion accepted. Maester, yay or nay?
Yay.
There you got this big, big yay. Even though I think I could take them on, I ain't scared of no dragons or no one. Let's do a big yay because we got to help them Vodlins out. You know what I'm saying? yay. And then I also say we make them citizens right away so they can vote. Yep, let's do that. So yay, yay, yay.
Yeah, and the governor's like, right. Thaddeus, yay or nay? Fortify Calaman.
Yay.
Illustrious. Yay. Affirm. Yay. All right. Seems like the yays have it. The proposal will be that we will fortify Calaman and not retaliate for Vogler.
Now that will require a 20% increase in the budget of the stonemasons.
Indeed. And I'm sure it'll be more than that after Marshal Nestra provides the military details and military costs to what that means. Marshal Nestra, is there anything
funds
you need
for,
to add?
I need funds for my ships and shipbuilders to rebuild their ships.
And surely, if I am to contain these refugees, even in a mansion, we must make sure they do not spread their diseases.
And then, like, the governor's just like, he looks like he's like containing a migraine. As the marshal's like, of course, we will consider all of your positions, and you all will be in charge of budgets that are accommodating to this proposal. And then Theriata says, yeah, don't worry about the money, folks. I got you. If you need something done, I'll get it done. You know me. The marshal's like, we're going to need to really, really stack up on, we need to build as many scorpions as we possibly can fit onto our walls, and I will get going on the training of all those devices as soon as possible. We will make it so that Consaldi will fear showing even one dragon in our skies.
Then we are resolved.
And then the governor's like, yes, Marshal, I will see you in charge of that. That is out of the jurisdiction of the High Council. But
Nobody
you will come up with all
me.
That. Sorry, what did you say?
Nobody listens to me.
The governor's like, what is it, Maester?
Well, never mind.
All right. The second proposal, then, is regarding housing. We still don't have a firm proposal here. Lord Illustrious is going to offer his, sorry, all the dogs are like rushing in and it's a bit chaotic right now. Lord Illustrious is proposing to give housing based out of his mansion and also to move funding toward public housing. However, I feel that we can't let the Bronze Bombers get fully away with their crimes. So I suggest we add an amendment of some sorts so that they are able to pay back the city and serve us if we are to agree with the funding of Vogler. And then Theriadis kind of jumps in.
It's obvious. We give the Voglins proper housing thanks to Illustrious's generosity and blah, 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 on the condition, as Thaddeus and Maester already pointed out, on the condition that the Bronze Bombers work for us. It's classic business. You got a rival or a nuisance in your way, Governor? You buy them out. You take them in. You take them in. So I says they either A, join our military, or B, have them spy and scout for us. Sounds like they're good at both of these things. They'll feel like they have a choice, too, if we give them that. They'll have two choices, right? What do you think?
I think I would like to also follow this because, I mean, they don't have to join their military, but I could use a few men to, well, that's not important, but I could use a few good men to do some things for me. So I like the idea of hiring them on. Pay them dirt cheap. Just their rent alone is fine.
And Theriadis is like, oh yeah, I would definitely use their services as well. I say, it's easy. We make them work for us. They're so skilled. They help Illustrious. They thwarted some dragon or whatever. They punched some guy. Well then, let's make them go to work for us. And then we give the Voglers all they want. It's a deal they can't refuse, Governor.
Indeed, I agree. There are other authorities we must consider. However, we should be able to keep them under our thumb. We should watch them like a wound to make sure that they don't fester.
Yeah, so to be very clear, guys, this is great. So getting out of character a little bit, we are deciding the fate of the Bronze Bombers. Ultimately, the Bronze Bombers, spoiler alert, will get a choice, right? But this is what we're doing right now. So to be very clear, there's maybe some murmurs around the table at Maester talking about the Bronze Bombers being a disease that needs to be kept under the thumb. Thaddeus wanting them to work for something. Lots of
part of his criminal organization is what he wants them for.
Yeah, I think Theriadus knows exactly what you're talking about, Thaddeus.
DM?
Yeah.
Is there a messenger or a page or any sort of servants that Maester can?
Yeah, sure. The High Council can have anyone they want.
So during that, bring me my wine.
Okay. Yes, Maester. And some little servant kind of rushes around the corner. Takes a few minutes so we can still talk, but they eventually come as we keep talking. Yeah, everyone, I'm guessing, or a lot of us have servants, except noticeably Alastrius. And Theriadus surprisingly has no visible servants. And the governor's like, I do find this proposal favorable, Theriadus. Well done.
We could always use more stone men, but I recall the little one, the tide wielder, mentioning some mechanic. Perhaps there's also some skilled laborers we could use.
And the governor says, indeed, we will recruit as many of these useful Voglins as we can, but this is specifically for the Bronze Bombers. I'm in agreement with Theriadus that they should be, if they're good with the sword, then we will use their sword, whether it be for the military or for some kind of covert operations, I do not care. Either way, they will be under our watchful guise, specifically yours, Marshal Nestra. I think you should supervise them if this is their situation. And the marshal kind of like, she looks like she doesn't really care too much. She's like, sure. What's more people to supervise? She says, on one condition, actually, I get to train the Salamnia boy and see what his skills are like. And he will be under my watchful mentorship and tutelage.
Why do you get them? Why can't I have
one? Oh, I'm sorry, Thaddeus. What do you know about the Knights of Salamnia?
Nah, but I could use that little Kender boy. He's small and is probably good at getting information.
Well, his name is Sneak, so I imagine there's a reason for that. And it sounds like but they will be under my supervision. So sure, Thaddeus, if you need them for lugging cargo, I guess, then you can use them. But their military and covert operations will take precedent. Can we all agree to that? And then Theriadus is like, oh, of course, sure. And Alastrius looks like he has his head on his hand on his head, kind of face palming and not super, like pretty visibly not super loving this conversation. He's like, well, we should still give them the benefits of whatever they join, of course, right? They're not just going to be military servants. And then the marshal's like, of course, Alastrius, we'll take care of them. Thaddeus just kind of like, eh. Then the governor says, well, unless there's anything more to add, then it sounds like our proposal is to, if the Bronze Bombers wish for us to provide funding for housing for Vogler, they must serve us. And that service is their choice. It'll be either serving us in the or serving us as scouts or spies. Are we all in agreement of this? And they will be supervised by Marshal Nestra herself.
Aye.
All right, we have an aye from Thaddeus, Alastrius. And Alastrius is kind of like, we can't do a better deal than this, really. And then the governor looks at him firmly and is like, yay or nay, Alastrius, or abstain. And Alastrius is like, abstain. And he actually abstains. All right, Maester, do you agree, yay or nay, to have the Bronze Bombers serve us, and then we will move funds toward the Voglin refugees and into the slum restructuring?
Yes, I think that'll suit me, us, well.
Theriadus, big old
yay. You know me, I can tell. I got amazing, we call it insight nowadays. I got amazing insight. These kids are good. They're a good crew.
I think they'll do great things for us, and maybe for me too. Yay. I vote yay. A firm yay. Have them work for us. Buy them in. All right. Thaddeus? You already said yes, actually. Did I miss anyone? Onyx, shit, Onyx.
Yay.
The yays have it then, and the proposal moves forward. Bring them in. And we'll say that the servants kind of come in at the same time with your wine, Maester. Asteriadis kind of like moves his hand to tell you all to come back in. He's like, come on, get over here. We got some great news for you all. And I think that's where we'll take a break. But you all can kind of think of that option, right? Military or spy scouts or maybe something else. You obviously can say whatever you want. But that'll be where we start at after break.
A few minutes later.
But yeah, so let's just get going. So the Bronzebird and Darrett, let's say Bronzebird and Darrett, let's not forget about our boy. I feel like Lord Bakaris is probably, you know, there's some handmaidens coming in and kind of putting, you know, ice packs on Bakaris the younger's head as he sits next to his dad now. He's still pretty unconscious, but they're taking care of him. Darrett, by the way, like, well, actually, if you guys want, we can have a small moment where you all talk as the Bronzebirds outside of the meeting, if you want to. I'm totally okay with that. I'll say that Darrett looks pretty angry, but also kind of still this weird fogginess, right? His hometown and village were destroyed today still. He's talking to these shitty elites who laughed at him for being a Knight of Salamnia for just today. Not even a full 24 hours. He's not in a great spot right now. And he tried to beat the shit out of Lord Bakaris the Younger. So get kind of the scene, sorry, as you guys step out. As they're like, you know, everything we had with our High Council is happening, you know, right now. They're all shouting and like, eh, I say we blah, blah, blah. And it's kind of all pretty muffled. You can't hear it too well.
I think as we exit the doors, Sneak's like, dude, I am shitting bricks. Am I the only one or...
I feel like she could tell that I have the tie. I mean, Lyx, you already told her. Oh my gosh. Oh no.
I didn't want to tell anyone else's secrets. I just wanted us to, I don't know, like have some leverage or make them feel like we weren't lying so
yeah,
much.
Yeah, I see that as a good move.
And they already knew.
Oh, sorry.
Vute already, so I don't think there was anything wrong with you coming out with it. They were feeling suspicious of us, and we know we're not lying, so you did the right thing.
I just don't trust them. Lyx, I want you to be okay.
I also feel like she's the only one that's maybe looking out for us, and of course, Mr. Illustrious.
Whatever we do, we gotta keep our guard up.
Yeah, I think the only one who's really that competent in there is Nestra. But I think I see some useful people in situations we can kind of try to be on the good side of.
And I mean, if it keeps us, you know, on the side of Fogler, I'm willing to do just about anything.
And then Derek's like, me too. Even if it means, I don't know, giving myself away to them. Especially if it protects you all and Vogler. I'm willing to do it. I'm a Knight of Salamnia now, and I'm sure that they'll want something from me.
Well, it's fine if they want something from us. I think fair trade is fair trade. I'm not particularly of the opinion of giving myself away. I'm willing to work with them and do what they want. I don't know how you guys feel, but I like my independence as much as I can.
I definitely don't
want
to give
time,
myself
I am
away. Yeah, I definitely don't want to give myself away. And that Thaddeus dude gives me creepy vibes, dog.
And also the Maester, I agree, Melvin. What were you going to say?
Well, no matter what happens in there, we just got to try and stick together. We're the Bronze Bombers, dang it. Damn it, even.
And if we can stay in Illustrious's mansion, It really is quite nice, and it could be a great base for us.
Yeah, you've been in there before. How many people can it fit? Because we have hundreds of refugees. We saved almost the entire city, which wasn't huge, but that's a lot of people.
I mean, I think it can fit all the Voglins.
Yeah, but what about the other refugees? I really obviously want to look after Vogler, but there's been others that have been here for a long time. I feel they might look at Vogler ugly if only they get these privileges.
Unless we use that privilege to try to help them out as soon as we can.
That's good.
Like
yeah,
I said,
sorry,
we have...
I'm getting ahead of myself. I think this is Becklin speaking or something in me.
No, I think that's a good point.
And it's not a bad person to be speaking through you, at least. But it's a good point she brings up. Maybe we should give effort just as much as camaraderie to the people, the other refugees that aren't Voglers.
It won't matter much to Ignia and Consoldi when they come. If they come. When they come.
Derek kind of, at the mention of him saying Becklin, he actually starts bursting into tears. Finally. And he kind of like, yeah, he's just bawling. And he starts thanking you all for everything, just everything you guys have all done. And for... We're waiting for you. Okay, shit.
I'm so sorry.
Am I
no,
back?
You're good.
Everything shut down on me. Okay,
the music's still going.
We're back. Okay.
When? Okay, cool. Yeah, very emotional moment. Just thanking you all for everything, really. He's just listing everything that you guys have done good for him and Vogler. And then he actually ends with thank you all, especially for stopping me from hurting Bakaris more. I know maybe he deserves it, but something overcame me, and that wasn't me.
It's called anger. It's righteous anger, but you don't want to take it too far. A little bit helps the steam go, but not that. Sorry, that was IRL lightning. Yeah, just telling him that it's okay to let some of it be consumed by the rage. I completely lost my train.
No, he's like, yeah, Mr. Ispin used to say something like that too. I don't know how Becklin will be there, even in the worst moments. I guess I still have a lot of learning to do. And yeah, I guess I'm imagining like him just like you all are kind of crowding him, hands around his shoulders, just kind of hugging you all. And he's just like, thank you all so much. Really, you guys can always count on me. You know that. And I know I can count on you all.
We promised Becklin we'd protect you, but even if we hadn't, we would.
And you guys are all just, I feel like, together. There's some guards kind of walking by suspiciously, but they're...
Did the Carses get thrown out with us? Are they listed?
Still in. They're still in. The governor still values Lord Bakaris, and probably sees him as mayor still.
Okay. All right.
Let's just promise, though, we got to make sure to remain as a team. The Bronze Bombers are eternal. We will be things of legends. People will write songs and stories of us. That's the one thing that must remain.
Well, I hope they don't write too many stories or songs. That's my job.
Derek kind of laughs at that.
Legends or die trying.
And then a servant knocks on the door. The High Council is ready to see you all. And you guys can see Theriatus's big old grin as he's waving at you all. And he's like, we got some great news for you, Bronze Bombers. We're going to take good care of you. Come on in.
We'll walk in together, I guess, unless somebody has an alternate plan.
And a servant kind of offers Derrett some tissues. Some tissues, sire. And then Derrett's like, thank you, yeah. And then he's kind of wiping his face. And he marches in.
Sneak will follow and then goofily curtsy.
Okay, so Sneak walks in and you do a little goofy curtsy to the High Council with your fucking, by the way, weird ass rose bloodstained shirt on top of your weird armor, your mask face, weird tattoos, just the weirdest fucking guy.
I was in the mood.
Curtsying. And Theriatus kind of does a little clap like good style, yeah. Good form. And Elastrius, you all kind of notice, actually, do a perception check. We haven't rolled too many dice. Let's do perception checks here.
14. Lyx is walking in, death staring the governor.
He has a big old smirk on. Since you said that,
I did 20.
The perception will matter for other things, but since you said you're looking dead at the governor, he has a big smirk on his face, like a really confident smirk, very smug, confident smirk, and his hands kind of crossed. Oh, 20? God, okay, sneak. God damn it. 11 for Melvin. Okay, I'll say, Lyx, you see the governor, like I said, and so Lyx and Melvin, oh God, Holly or Willow, you are just, I don't know, you're not paying attention. I don't know if the nerves are hitting Willow or if you're really focused on the moment with Derrit, maybe. Is there something going on in Willow's head that she would just not be paying attention that much to the faces of the people right now? Maybe she's happy. You know, maybe it's a good thing. Maybe you're really happy about the moment you just had.
I think she's probably trying to read the room, but maybe got distracted by Theriatus being so exuberant. She doesn't really trust him quite yet. She thinks he could be helpful. But yeah, she might have gotten distracted by him being so happy and wondering if that's a good thing for us or if it's not.
Yeah, you guys, and I'll say that you actually make eye contact with Theriatus, and he just gives you a big old grin, and you can see his two gold fangs and almost shining in the light of the room. I'm thinking like Chip Skylark, Fairly Odd Parents bullshit there. Shiny teeth. Very, very perfect white, pearly whites, except for those beautiful gold fangs. Other than that, that's all you noticed. I'll say that Lyx and Melvin, you know, you see a content group. They look pretty content. They look happy. Marshall Nestra's kind of just leaning against the wall as always with her head down, hands crossed, acting nonchalant as ever since you've met her in this weird room. Maybe you focus on Lord Bakaris actually tending to his son, trying to take care of him and just trying to wake him up a little bit. Sneak, you see all of the things that I said, but Sneak, you also notice there's something off about this room with that natural 20, or I guess it's a dirty 20? Yeah, it's a dirty 20. There's something off with this room that you can't put your finger on it, right? Because this is still just perception, but you feel like there's more to this room than meets the eye. This place was used for something else. I mean, obviously, this was the throne room, right? This is where the previous king and queens would rule Calaman. But you feel like there's another purpose here.
So it's not the people in the room, it's the room itself.
No, you notice all the people, everything I said about them, but the room itself, yeah. And to be more specific, just the arrangement of all these weird, so they're kind of like empty displays. Or like almost like signs saying like things were here but ain't here no mo. It catches your eye, you know, maybe none of you have really noticed it too much, but it catches your eye and the orientation of it, you're like, there's something here. And for some reason your brain, just because, maybe because it's obsessed with this topic, just keeps going to the Knights of the Rose, Knights of the Rose, Knights of the Rose. You keep just thinking of that. You keep thinking of the rose and you kind of look at your own rose on your dead great 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 grandma's shirt, Jandin. So you kind of think about her. You have no idea at all what connections could be made, and you kind of are kind of spitballing out of your ass, but you feel like something's off here. Okay, and then the governor looks at you all and says, well, we've come to a decision. Marshal Nestra, since you will be overseeing them all, and I imagine as he says that, that might be a shock to some of the Bronze Bombers. Why don't you give them the news and give them their choice, right? And he has like this very like proud smirk and smile on his face. And then Marshal Nestra says, sure. And then she looks at you all and says, all right, we've come to the decision that we will put funding toward restructuring the slums, giving Vogler priority to the slums, and also discussing with Elastrius how many Voglins can go into his mansion through his generous donation. Regarding the slums, we will provide the funding as long as you serve us. and Calaman. You all will have to join the military, and you'll either support us as army soldiers or as scouts or spies. And then all the High Council looks like really smug, and like, you know, Theriatus maybe is like playing with his little gold coin, looking at you all, kind of smiling, like with his like eyebrows up. Elastrius, like, he has his head down and he's just kind of nodding in disbelief, his long hair kind of waving around, right? His long white hair waving around. And I'm guessing the other High Council members are also pretty smug right now and pretty happy with this decision. And then Marshal Nestor looks at you and says, or there's a third option. And immediately, as that's said, the governor looks like shocked and angry again. And she says, you all can serve Calaman with your skills however you see fit. The council members are shocked, right? Theriatus is immediately like, what the fuck? And the governor's like, Marshal, what is the meaning of this? And he's absolutely livid, like veins in his neck. And then Marshal Nestor looks at all of them. And by looking at them, she's kind of like looking out into space, but still her stare finally is looking at them. She gets off the wall. She walks up to the table and stares at everybody. Her two epic swords now next to her, kind of more visible. Her roses on her shoulder pads, more visible to you all. And she says, as Marshal, I can amend all proposals related to law and military. You all should really read your stupid laws. So, Bronze Bombers, what do you pick? Regardless of your choice, you will answer to me. So now she's actually giving you all a surprise third choice. So you will be a part of the military, no matter what. That means that, but within that, you will be either in the army as soldiers, scouts, or spies, or some weird third option if you guys, as, you know, even out of character, have an idea of how you want the Bronze Bombers to move forward.
Folks, I know one thing's for sure. A great deed, a great debt is paid to the city of Calaman for the help that they are willing to offer. I do want to interject so wholeheartedly that we are a team and we need to do whatever together. I know they have been able to help my scouting abilities 3 times fold than I was able to do by myself just because of their help. That is all I can say. I just hope whatever we do, we can stay remaining as a team and you don't split us up because our power in ourselves won't be there. It'll be a little bit, but really what makes a Bronze Bomber so special is every role that everybody plays. Or split us up, I don't care.
Marshal Nestor says, no, your skills, from every report we've received, especially from Mr. Elastrius, it sounds like it's your teamwork that has taken you this far. You all will stay together. The only one that I actually will make an exception for and wanting to train on my own is Mr. Darrett Highwater here. And then Darrett's kind of like taken aback by that. He's like, but we'll get to that later. So Bronze Bombers, this is for you. If you want Vogler to receive the funding it needs in order to have housing here, you will need to serve us either as soldiers, as spies, or some other option that you can come up with right now.
Well, I would like one quick clarification on Derrett's behalf. We as a group promised Becklin personally that we would take care of him. I just want to make sure that we could still keep good on that. I think he would benefit greatly from training with you, and I would also love to train with you sometime, but I just want to make sure we would still be able to keep true to that.
And she says, oh, well, that's a surprise. We can discuss this at another time then. But it sounds like you'll have to meet me at the training grounds with Darrett himself then. The Knights of Salamnia training grounds as soon as the morning breaks.
I guess just ultimately, can we be something other than scout and military? Can we be that sweet middle ground? Because sometimes we come in heavy. Sometimes we come in soft.
Then Theriatus actually perks up. He's like, yep, you know what? That's a good idea. use them when we need a muscle, but also they can do their little whatever, spy things if they're so good at that. I'm okay with that, even though I guess we don't got no power according to the books here.
And then the marshal looks at you all right, bronze bombers. Do you like what Mr. Sneak has said here? The in-between? Well then, you will be reporting to me then moving forward, and I will be supervising y'all. And it sounds like Willow and Darrett, I will be seeing you early in the morning. Now, Governor, if we could be please done with this, unless anyone has anything else to say.
What's happening to Not Mayor and his useless son over here? Has that been decided? Because I'm very interested in that.
Yes, that's a good point. Lord Bakaris, you are immediately enlisted in the military of Calaman, and you will be serving as a general. Since you are so interested in leading a military charge to Vogler, I will be reviewing your credentials as soon as possible, and you will be in charge of certain sects of our squadrons. And then Lord Bakar is kind of nervously is like, yes, of course, I will take that honor with me, even though you've done me a great disservice here. Yes, I will join, and I'm sure my boy will too. Sign him up. I know he'll say yes when he comes to. Just, he says yes. And then he raises like his son's hand up as he's like knocked out and drooling. And then the governor is just, he's silent, but he looks like he's about to explode with anger. Asteriadis is kind of calmed down. He's like, this sounds good to me. Marshal, you do what you want. You know, you read the books, you benefit from the books, right, folks? This is only our fault. She's got the books down, you know? And Elastrius kind of looks at the marshal and he's like, thank you, Marshal. I think this is a more fair arrangement for the Bronze Bombers who have done so much for the Calaman Museum of Art and History, and also for Vogler, and now for Calaman itself. He's like, Bronze Bombers, are you all okay with this agreement?
As you're chowing down. Melvin sort of looks around at the group.
I did just put a kink in the cog of the original idea. Are you guys still cool with this idea?
I'm okay with it.
Where'd you go, bud? I'll follow.
Darrett says anything for Vogler, and anything for you guys.
Together.
Yeah, and Darrett pretty much says the same thing, like, anything together, and anything for Vogler.
For Vogler.
And then the governor finally looks up and he kind of like talks to a servant. He's like whispering, and the servant kind of like nods their head. And then he's just like shaking his head in anger. He's like, very well. Then the Bronze Bombers will, whatever that means, serve the glorious in-between of soldiers and spies, and basically do as they please to serve Calaman. And the marshal looks pretty happy. And Elastrius looks really happy. They're on being chill. How are the other High Council members feeling? Darius looks pretty happy. He looks pretty content.
I think Thaddeus
sort of looks to the side, is taking stock of each of the council members, just sort of nods, not really saying much.
Thaddeus has this...
Probably ready to take a nap.
Thaddeus has this intention that he won because now he's going to get the Bronze Bombers to do whatever they want, like, for his own political and like corporate gain, but it's far from the truth. So he's like delusional happy in like the most subtle way. So he's like
Yeah, he maybe didn't fully understand the amendments that Sneak proposed. and like the fact that you all still Marshal Nestra has supreme authority over your choices. Style, so basically, if you all, she'll tell you this later, but just so you know, if you all don't want to do something that the High Council commands related to military or spy things, Marshal Nestra can overrule it. So yeah, Thaddeus does not understand fully the position here.
Will this change the budget?
The governor says the budgets will have to be decided. These are merely proposals we will put into law once the budgets are made, Onyx. You will have to come up with the budgets for the restructuring of the slums that our friend Elastrius has so kindly put into motion.
It will be costly.
And Elastrius looks at you kind of nervously, Onyx, and is like, I'll help you out, don't worry, dear. And I have so many great accountants and nerds at the museum that they'll be more than willing to help you out, Onyx, old friend.
I have no doubt. Perhaps I'll see you this evening.
Yes, we must celebrate. Yes, we can celebrate these great motions to protect the people of the hinterlands. That's the big region, actually, of Calaman and Vogler, the hinterlands. Hinterland Woods, if you remember. You guys were in the Hinterland Woods. And then the governor, kind of, again, massaging some kind of migraine. If that will be all, then I will dismiss our High Council meeting. Good day, everyone. And then he storms off and, like, glares at all of you. And actually, shit, let me see. Who's looking at him the most ugly right now?
I mean, Lyx death stared at him. I don't know.
Oh, yeah. For sure that happened. He goes up to you, Lyx, and, like, goes up to your ear, puts his hand on your shoulder, and says, "You will be under our watchful eye. You be careful now." And then he walks off.
The maester sort of scurries after him. And, my lord, if you will just hear me for a moment, I mean the cats. We must talk about the cats.
Yeah, and the governor's kind of like picking up his pace with his servants. As the maester runs out past you all, past the bronze bombers and Darrett. I love this. Yeah, how do the High Council members exit? I'll say Elastrius is going to wait a little bit.
Anna gets up, winks at Elastrius, and does a little stretch, starts making her way.
Thaddeus Timberjaw just stands up and, like, kind of throws the black shawl over himself and kind of floats away like he's some snervious Snape. I don't know if I said that right. And he was like, he's some sort of Snape, you know? He's like from Harry Potter. Anyways.
Like, he's super hot shit, basically. The cape flowing. And then, like, maybe doesn't even look down at the bronze bombers. Just kind of, like, walks past them.
100%.
Of a man of great importance. And then Theriat is kind of looking at you all. He finally gets up, and he's kind of, like, has his hands in the air. And he's like, "Well, that couldn't have gone better for you all. Look at that. Look at that. You guys are excellent negotiators. I'm going to keep a keen eye on all of you, too. You two, you all of you seem real, real competent." And then he kind of, like, winks at all of you. And then he kind of says, he looks at you, Sneak. He says, "Oh, and Sneak, can I show you something real quick?"
Sure.
And then he snaps his fingers, and out of the blue, a giant minotaur appears, and a red robe that was holding the minotaur, like touching the minotaur, someone in pure red robes, pale white, they look like maybe they're bald, they have all these creepy, like, black tattoos coming out from under their eyes. This minotaur looks like a giant, you know, 7 to 8 foot person, super wide, insanely buff. And it looks like the guy on the right with this kind of, like, mafia getup. And he, like, looks at you, Sneak, and he, like, crouches down. Theriatus, who's kind of tall, he crouches down to your level and he says, "Just watch yourself when you talk to me, okay, Sneak? I think we could be really good friends, but we should stay friends, right? These are my friends right above you." And this giant bull, like, kind of, like, comes right behind you, Sneak. And goes, it kind of does, like, the cow, like bull thing. And then the red robe person is just kind of smiling, like, really creepy, and just has their head down. And you can't really see their eyes with the robe over them. "Now, these are my pals. This is Asteros, the big guy behind you, and Red. We just call them Red."
I'm going to whisper in his ear, "They're real cute. Are they good kissers?"
And then Theriatus says, "Oh, I hear great things about the kissing. And if we get on good sides, who knows? Maybe I can arrange something with you all, huh?"
Looking forward to it, buddy.
And then he starts, like, patting your, like, shoulder, like, really hard. "Oh, I like you, Sneak. I like you, Sneak." He's like, "All right." And then he snaps his fingers. And he's like, "All right, let's go, boys. Oh, my bad. Let's go, Asteros and Red." And he's kind of, like, walking away, like, pretty coolly, as this giant bull, like, is staring you down. The red robe person kind of walks away, and the bull's just looking at you all intensely, almost, like, red in their eyes. And he says, "Pleasure to meet you all." And then he keeps walking. So these two beings just came out of invisibility. You guys can definitely react if you want to say anything more.
I'll just say that Willow definitely like tensed up because, you know, she doesn't have C invisibility or anything, so she, as far as I know, had no idea they were there, but knows that she kind of has to keep calm, so tries to brush it off.
Yeah, and Lyx, and maybe Sneak too, you immediately realize, like, oh god, that red robe probably casted like invisibility from their own abilities, right? And was doing what you guys did, right? Basically, touching this bull to keep him invisible. But this was not a potion. This was not a spell scroll. This was them. And so, yeah, Theriadus, who seemed like he had no one next to him, actually had these two invisible people with him. And then, so then it's pretty much just Marshal Nestra and Alastria's. Marshal Nestra and Alastria. I'm laughing at Colton's message. And Alastrius in the room now. Lord Bakaris like kind of shuffles past you all and he's like, I'm not done with you all. You stay out of my way.
We're not done with you either.
Enjoy your service.
You're lucky this blind woman can't see a damn thing. And then he storms out of the room.
She sees more than you think.
Yo, straight up fuck these dudes.
That's your catchphrase. And like Bakaris the younger is kind of coming too, and like his dad's kind of helping him. It's a somewhat, I don't want to say wholesome moment between them two, but it's the most that you've seen Bakaris the senior help his son out. And Bakaris the younger is just kind of like still like, and he doesn't really know what's going on. He's just kind of walking away with his dad. Kind of like if you're helping a friend after a very long night of being drunk as hell, kind of that vibe. And Lastrius comes to you all once again. Sorry, this is a little theme I had from the first time you ever met him in Mount Kuwamba with the painting. He takes off his little hat. Do you all remember how he looks, or should I bring him up? With, you know, red hat, he's got nice red clothing. He takes off his hat again, and his big white long hair, you know, goes almost touching the ground. As he curtsies to you all, and he says, well, my friends, this is the most pleasant surprise. I certainly did not expect to see you all so soon, and especially not in these conditions. Now you know one of my jobs, and the group of people I hang around with. What'd you all think?
Some pretty strange acquaintances, Alastrius. Oh,
that's putting it lightly.
I would appreciate it if you didn't tell them about my, you know, friend.
Yes, I actually did leave that part out, mostly because I don't even know what's going on there, to be honest.
Keep it that way, yeah?
Yes, of course. And then he kind of tries to do like a cool, like granddad, like punch on your shoulder kind of thing, really light. like super light, and is almost trying to miss you purposely, but I guess it still like gets a reaction out of Melvin. He's like, oh, I'm so sorry. He actually apologized. Oh, I'm so sorry. I've seen Theriadus do that. I'm sorry. But a pleasure to see you all, and I hope I can see you all very soon. I'd be happy to give you a tour myself, for our great exhibits at the Calaman Museum of Art and History. We are undergoing some renovations at the moment and in installing new exhibits. You know how it is in the art world. So things won't be quite ready for a few more days yet, but perhaps in 3 more days or so we can all arrange something and chat about some good old art and history. You still have your membership cards I gave you, right?
Yeah, our city just burned down, but yes, we do have our cards still.
Right, if you need more than 3 days, of course, but that's when the exhibits will be ready, my dear. Take all the time necessary for Vogler, of course, and honestly, I will need time to arrange everything at my mansion now that I have given it away, apparently.
Why did you do that?
What do you mean, my dear Lyx?
Why would you give up your mansion, Lord Alastrius?
Well, I don't really care much for my legacy, or at least not my family's legacy. I don't have children of my own. It's all a bunch of luck, just the luck of the dice that I was given such things. And I can find something else, a little more quaint. It's a bit too bombastic for me anyways, and it's so much to maintain. And you know, you worked in there. So much, it's too much for one person.
Indeed. Will you live close by, or?
Of course. Calaman has become my home. I'm sure I can find somewhere else in the inner circle of Calaman to reside. I'll arrange that immediately. Worst comes to worst, there's always, the steady beacon and nice taverns of such to hold my way until I have something a bit better. But it feels like the least I could do for Vogler after everything you've all done. And Willow, I did not forget to commend everyone in the retrieval of the portrait of Lidara of the Flaming Sword. That's actually one of the exhibits being put in still right now and installed. Took some time to make sure we got everyone's names down. And he nods, he kind of like takes his hat off again and kind of in like respect. And I do truly mourn the loss that you've all felt in Vogler. And it seems like he kind of wants to ask more, but he's scared. He doesn't really know who's alive and who's not. And he's just kind of like generalizes it as if for everyone you've all lost, I truly do wish to pay my respects. And I hope this small token is some kind of token of appreciation for Vogler, a place I very much love. And for Sir Ispin and Sir Becklin, who have been great friends of mine in the past. And Derek kind of, looks a little nervous at that again, but just kind of shows appreciation as well. And maybe pats Illustrious's shoulder. And he kind of says, thank you, Mr. Voute. I'm sure the people of Vogler will appreciate this. Let us know if you need any help at all, and maybe I'll join in on the museum tour. I'm normally a pretty big history head myself. He's like, yes, but of course, take all the time you need, son. I know it's a lot. But anyways, I won't hold you all any longer. A pleasure to see you all, my friends, and I'll be seeing more of you, it looks like. Well, toodaloo! And he kind of like tips his hat to you all. His cane is out, right? And he starts walking away with his cane, a little jolly, a little more pep in his step. And then finally, Marshal Nestra comes up to you all. She's not too tall, maybe like a little less than 6 feet. Yeah, sorry, I'm reading what Lyx said. That's true. Lyx, you're kind of thinking all of this started with Ispin and with the painting, right? It started with Illustrious's mission to help retrieve the painting of Lidara, this legendary hero of the past. Yep, that's where the journey began for all of you. That's where the Bronze Bombers united, and the guy.
Oh my God! Wait, did you just say Lidara?
Yeah, that's the name of the person in the painting.
And the person in the singing.
That's also her name. Yeah, Lidara. Yep. Interesting, isn't it?
I've been waiting for us to come back to that one, but yeah.
I mean, maybe Lyx does. Lyx is thinking about it. Yeah, maybe Lyx is realizing this as the supreme military leader of Calaman is walking up to you all. So, yeah, she kind of walks up, and I'm actually going to share my screen again real quick just so we can get kind of how she looks. She's got long black hair. She's blind, obviously. She's got two really cool looking swords right now holstered into her sheaths. And then she's got a very interesting rose or flower like ornamentation on her shoulder pads, right? She's wearing the blue and gold, or sorry, the blue and silver of this Calaman, but also has this cool gold embroiderment around her armor. And it's Marshal Nestra. She's maybe as tall as Melvin. And Melvin, it looks like you wanted to say something. Just jump in.
Yeah, no, I had a question. Is she human?
She looks human, yep.
Okay.
Yep, she has a lot of hair. She has a lot of, like, black hair kind of over her ears. So, like, the telltale sign of an elf, it's hard to tell. But it seems like she's human. She also has this kind of bombastic, billowing cape. It's not super clear there. It's kind of like a scarf almost. That follows her as well. A little bombastic, a little maybe epic or something. Yeah, and she kind of like walks up to you all and says, all right, you all ready for your first assignment?
Do we really even have a choice to say no?
Ready as I'll ever be.
All right. Well, your first assignment, Bronze Bombers. And then she like leans in at all of you. And she's obviously not making direct eye contact with any of you, but she is looking at all of you as intensely as a blind person can. Your first assignment is to get stronger, learn more about the enemy, this city, and yourselves. Okay, bye. And then she starts walking away. She kind of like moves around you all, starts walking away. And then she looks back. Oh, well, Derek and I guess Willow, I will want to see you all at the Knights of Salamnia training grounds first thing in the morning. Actually, I'll give you guys a day to recover. 2 days from now, first thing in the morning. How does that sound? And then Derek's like, yes. And he's like kind of nervously and like kind of getting back into his like Ispin and Becklin like lame nerd mode. Yes, sir. Marshal Nestra, sir. Yes. I'll be there.
I'm just going to clap him on the shoulder and be like, yes, that sounds very amenable. Thank you for the day to rest. We'll be there.
Excellent. Well, you all have your first assignment. I expect a report at some time. And then she kind of says, all right, scrubs, get to it. And then do you guys say anything as she's walking away? That's it. That's all the details she's provided. Just get stronger, know more stuff, learn more stuff, get accommodated, basically.
If you could have one of our, if you could have one of your scribes draw up, you know, our commission orders, it'd be greatly appreciated. I value things in writing.
Sure. Hey, you. And then she like kind of points. And let's say that Bob the soldier somehow got his shit back, and is like rubbing his head and coming back. He's like, what? Oh, Marshal Nestra, sir, Supreme Commander Leader. Yes, sir. What's up, sir? And he's kind of panting. He's like, sorry, ma'am. I've had a bit of a weird night. I don't really know what happened. What do you need? And she's like, calm down, Private. What's your name? Bob. Yeah, Private Bob. What do you need, sir? She's like, just fill them in on the military stuff and all that boring crap and help them out. All right. Tell them what benefits they get and all the cool stuff. And he's like, sir, yes, sir. And she looks at you, Melvin. She's like, is that good enough, Melvin? Bob here is gonna be in charge of helping out the Bronze Bombers directly with any questions related to the military. And he can write stuff down for you, too, if you need it, Melvin. Excellent. Anything else? Any other questions? And then Bob and like kind of salutes again. And then Derek does as well. And as this is not your supervisor, guys. This is Marshal Nestra, the supreme leader, military leader of Caliman, your new boss, basically. She kind of like looks at Bob and Derek and is like, I see all the dogs now. She's like, I appreciate the formalities, you two. Have a good night, everyone. And then she walks down the halls. Well, how about we take a break there?
A few minutes later.
So yeah, welcome back. So you all are here with Bob the Soldier as Marshal Nestra is walking away, heading back. Am I here? Am I cutting out? I feel like my video looks slow. I'm good? Cool. And then Bob the Soldier, the guy that sneak you knocked out, I actually gave you all this as a handout. It's called Military Benefits in Roll 20. You should be able to see it in Roll 20. It's a little handout. It's just called Military Benefits. Do you all see it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Really simple stuff. I mean, I guess I should have added you all since you have this special position within the military. You'll be paid basically based on the achievements you do, right? On the things, the information you get. That kind of stuff. But the other stuff you get is that you all have access to Castle Caliman now, basically, especially the military tower of Castle Caliman, which includes the soldiers' quarters, so you all can sleep. You all have bunks available to you, only you all as military members. You can also obtain any mundane weapons you want from the barracks. So they have a full stock of usable weapons from the barracks. You can only rent two at a time, though. So if you had two rented already, you'd have to return at least one of them to get a new one. This is just a way that if you do want to mix and match your weapons, try out new things, that option is available to you for free. This is not something you have to buy. anymore. And you can use the soldiers' training grounds. Honestly, I don't even know what that means. Maybe I'll have a map that looks like a training ground where you can practice your abilities. Maybe I'll put dummies or something. I don't know. Something like that if you want to practice combat. Or maybe it'll just be I'll put the rules of combat or something in a page that I'll leave open, and that's the training ground. But yeah, so Bob fills you in on all says, yeah, and I guess if you guys have any questions about Calaman and where to find stuff, I can be your guy, I guess, if that's what the marshal's commanding me to do. Sorry, I've had a really weird night. I have no clue what's going on. I was talking to Joe just a moment, and I don't know, whatever. Hopefully it's not something crazy. I'm not having some, you know how those plays, they always start with the main character having amnesia and then he goes off on this epic adventure and he's like, oh, who am I? And hopefully that's not me, right?
Sounds yeah, like a Tarantino flick.
Oh, you mean Tarantino, the elf? Tarantino?
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Tintin Tarantino. Yeah. Oh yeah. His stuff is great. A bit grisly. Yeah. Great stuff, great plays. I've paid many a times to watch the same one. I admit it, I'm that guy.
Same.
Well, yeah, I mean, I guess I'll escort you all out, and if you have any questions about Calaman, Abby, it should be in the journal tab, and then it's just a little, the icon's kind of like an ugly blue page with lines, and it says military benefits.
Mine's orange as fuck.
I'll share with all players and with, huh?
In the Google
Drive? No, sorry, not in the Google Drive. This is Roll20. Roll20, sorry. You'll find it now. It's Roll20 in the journal, military benefits.
Okay.
I'll probably add more details on the payment thing, but I was kind of thinking the payment's based on the achievements you do, especially since you guys aren't actual soldiers. If you were actual soldiers, you would have more of a steady pay, but you'd also be responsible for more. Your position's more loose, so it's almost commission-based. But yeah, do you guys have any questions for Bob on Calaman? I'm also willing, and you know, out of character as a DM, I can just start explaining some of Calaman and whatever you want to do. If your characters are ready to go to bed, if you want to report back to the Voglins, or if you want to split up, I'm also okay with that.
Well, I do want to ask Bob a list of taverns, performance venues,
yeah,
busking spots.
Then he looks at you and he's like, oh yeah, the mid-ring is the place for all the best ones and the affordable ones. Yes, there's some excellent restaurants and taverns in the inner ring, but they're very snooty and incredibly expensive. But the mid-ring, you'll find all kinds of taverns, my friend. And you'll find great street vendors in the city markets. But if I had to give you one, you know, the clearest recommendation is the big old girl herself, the steady beacon down in the kind of southeast section of Calaman. Steady Beacon has the best ale, the best food. If you need a place to stay, it's great. It's a massive place. You'll find all kinds of folks there if you're trying to make friends and chat. And they have all kinds of rotating performers pretty much every night. Steady Beacon is my go-to place. That's where I go with the pals and the gals, too. But you'll find all kinds of taverns that your DM can improvise, I guess. But the Steady Beacon is ready to roll.
Rolling, we'll keep rolling. Yeah.
And then Bob's kind of like moving around with you and like dancing. He's feeling it. He's like, welcome to the military, bud. Yeah, and then I guess like with performers, I mean, we got performers everywhere. There, you can just pick a spot, my friend, and hope your best on the streets. Some of the taverns might want some more credentials, but you might be able to get some spots there too.
He just kind of hums in like a crazy scale and then does like 1, 3, 5, 7, 8.
Nice. Yeah, those are definitely really nice sounding sounds. And in fact, I find you quite endearing as me, Bob the Soldier. And I will state that out loud to you, Melvin, my friend, my new military pal. And he kind of like tries to copy your like thing and it sounds like shit, like absolutely terrible. He's trying to be really cool. Yeah, you're like, oh. Cool. Yeah. So taverns, what else do you guys want to know? And at this point, you guys are kind of like walking down the stairs. You see these epic like statues along the corridors, Castle Caliman, hands of soldiers, and maybe kings and queens. You see some portraits, especially maybe one that catches your eye as you're walking, of this blonde haired royal looking woman with an owl bear at the on a giant throne. That painting kind of catches all of your eyes. It's very grandiose and filling what looks to be kind of the normal like big entrance room of Castle Caliman, as you guys are now back from the second level back to the first floor, about to exit into the main courtyard. Yeah,
I think as we're passing that painting, Willow's just gonna ask, so who's that?
You don't know her? That's Queen Anastasia III. She's the one who, you know, 150 or so years ago declared the monarchy moot and moved us toward democracy and a representative government. Yeah, so she's kind of the awesome one that ended all that old timey bullshit. And now Caliman is seen as one of the most progressive cities on Kryn, where we serve the people and serve the truth.
And how much do you actually believe that?
Not much, but I get paid to say that, so I keep saying
it. Fair enough. I understand.
And also, she had a really cool owl bear, so she's pretty cool.
That's entirely why I asked.
Yeah, that thing, legend says that thing would rip apart anyone that messed with her, but it was also the most cuddly, cute buddy ever, at least for her.
Yeah, we faced one owlbear, and there wasn't much fighting. There was just a lot of running, so I believe that. Cool to know that they might be able to be tamed, though.
Yeah, she was awesome, or so I'm told by all our history shoved down our throats. Wow, you saw an owlbear? That's crazy. I've heard those things and have gotten the hell out of there as soon as possible. Not a pleasant sound. Cool, so, well, I think this is all I have to do. The marshal was not very clear, but I guess I'm your buddy in the castle if you guys need it.
Bob, if you could have me a favor, have some proper orders drawn up on parchment for our commission. When you get a moment, have Marshal Nestra sign it and have it sent to us down at the docks, my friend, my new friend.
Well, there should be a swearing in ceremony at some point. I think you'll receive all that nonsense then, but I guess if you need something further in advance, I feel like she would have just done it, but the marshal's kind of known for doing as she pleases and moving along, I guess. She's pretty, I mean, I still like her. I like her. And he's kind of like looking around nervously. You know, she's cool. But yeah, she, you know, people didn't always do things her way, and just pretty young. I mean, way younger than me, at least. But I'll get something. I'll ask her. She's probably just going to say, just tell him to wait for the swearing-in ceremony, though.
Very well, then. And you should be careful about people's ages. You know, looks can be deceiving.
Ain't that the truth, brother? Ain't that the truth?
Hey, also, we don't come cheap. Let her know that.
Well, then you shouldn't have joined the military. He starts like kind of like laughing. He's like, I'm sure you'll find money, bud. You'll figure it out. You look like a resourceful and interesting guy. And he's kind of like looking at your armor really well, and noticing all your weird shit and bloodstained stuff. Yeah.
I'm going to drink those military rations dry.
Yeah, the food is actually not too terrible. Believe it or not. It is when you're on the field, though. That's when it stinks. Alrighty, well, sounds like you guys are going to go get lit at a tavern. Enjoy yourselves. It was nice meeting you all. I am Bob, the highly developed soldier of Caliman. My head does kind of hurt, though. Fuck, I need to find an ice pack. And he kind of like awkwardly goes back to his hedge maze. Not his, but the hedge maze. Yeah, so you guys are out in the courtyard now. You see this beautiful, pretty well-lit courtyard, actually. There's all kinds of people still. It's not, like, super packed like it was when you first got here, but there's still some, like, a lot of couples, you know, look like they're maybe on dates, walking through, heading toward the east side of the Castle Calaman to enjoy the gardens, a couple families that might be out still, and then lots of guards just walking around, and it's just fully lit. So it looks like Melvin at least is ready to head back to the port, see how the Voglins are doing, check in on Mayor Raven, and then knock out. So yeah, your guys' options for sleep are basically, you know, just all of you in the soldiers' quarters of Castle Calaman are going back and seeing how the Voglins are doing and knocking out with them. I mean, I guess you can also fall asleep wherever. So this is free reign for you all.
Well, I think we should go back to the docks and tell Mayor Raven what's happened. I would hate for Bakaris to get the drop on her, and I think she should hear all of these developments from us.
I agree. I'd also like to see how the townspeople are doing and finally bring them back some good news from today.
I gotta check on my family, so the docks is the option.
I kind of want to go see the family that I used to stay with, but I trust you all to deliver the message, and if you could tell my parents that I went to go see the Rutineals.
I won't leave you alone. I'll go with you.
I was going to ask, do you want us to come with, or would you prefer to go alone?
Yeah, if you want to go alone.
Like to be alone with
it. And then Darrett says, Lyx, you're strong enough to handle yourself, and you've been here alone many times. We'll see you in the morning.
Yep.
Awesome.
Aye, take care.
Cool. So let's do, actually, for the sake of time, let's do the group first. That's not Lyx. You all head back to the port with Lyxless. Port looks kind of like this, except there is a new detail now. All the tents are actually put up around the port now. Imagine more tents for like sleeping. And there's a lot of people in like gray, kind of like drab, and also kinds of all kinds of normal people and some Voglins that you all recognize. And it seems like they're kind of being pointed out by Fizban, the dark-skinned gentleman with a bald head. It looks kind of old, and sort of sounds like a very kind Gantu from Lilo and Stitch. He's kind of like ordering them around, it seems like. And they're actually pretty decent tents. Like, it looks like they really tried to make as best of an effort, this group with Fizban and with Mayor Raven, to get as many blankets as possible, to get tents that aren't total sacks of crap. And they're set up everywhere. And you know, it's actually a pretty quiet scene. It's a lot less people than what you see now. Maybe the Delings are actually still at the docks, kind of chilling. Although maybe Ma and Pa are already knocked out. Sneak, I'll say. Actually, you know what, Sneak? The Delings have hammocks set up from this dock to the other dock, hanging on the post of the docks. And it looks like Ma and Pa are already knocked out in those hammocks that they set up. Sly and Smarts are at the edge of the dock, just kind of kicking their feet and back and forth and kind of chilling. But yeah, the rest is what I described. You guys don't really see Buff or really anyone, it seems like, from where you enter. But this will be actually very interesting. Melvin and Willow and Sneak, you do all see Mayor Raven kind of helping Waywin, who's now on crutches. And Mayor Raven's kind of like helping walk him around, with Bill Bricks kind of holding his hand on the other side. And Mayor Raven seems to be taking the brunt of like helping move him around and stuff. We'll say that they're like over here somewhere, and I'll move Waywin over there. And Fizban's kind of somewhere in the center, just kind of commanding these people in these gray clothes. Yeah, so that's the scene. But it's mostly quiet. It's mostly still a pretty much, much calmer scene than before.
Melvin's kind of moving. We got stuff to talk to Mayor Raven about. Right, gang?
Cool. So yeah, you rush over to Raven, who's helping out Waywin, Lyx's dad, who has a broken foot now and can't walk on his own pretty much. He needs the help of people in crutches. So yeah, we'll say that he's actually not on crutches yet. It's just kind of Bill Bricks and Raven helping him up. Raven having to like lean down a decent amount. So she's getting a good leg workout. And then she notices you all and says, oh, it's good to see you all. And Derek kind of like gives them all a quick little hug. Well, any news on anything? And then for the sake of time, do you guys want to say just what happens? Just everything? Please. No secrets, just yeah. No secrets, just everything said, including the Bakaris bullshit.
Especially the Bakaris bullshit.
Especially the Bakaris bullshit. And she says, I see. Well, just so you all know, I am not mayor anymore. I am giving up that position, and I have given that position up. Right now, I am just a Voglin, and I'm here to help out all the Voglins I can. Maybe I'll look to become mayor again if Vogler is ever reestablished. But it seems like a useless title at this point. He can have it if he wants it so badly.
No, a title is earned. If you do not wish to have it at the moment, that is fine. But he, no, not him.
You're the mayor of former Vogler. Vogler may not exist, but you were the mayor. You will be forever.
I appreciate that. And that is forever all your choices, too. Ultimately, it's up to him to convince the Voglins of who's mayor. I don't really care what he says. Although him making choices like this for Vogler are rash, I'm happy to know that you all seemingly handled this well. And I can't believe the generosity that Elastrius is showing us once again. I just hope that, well, never mind. Sorry, I'm... And then you kind of, and then Derek's like, you were going to say that it's not fair, right, for all the other refugees. And she's like, yeah, I guess so. But maybe a conversation for another time. And we don't really have the say in all of this, I think. And then Waywin, he looks pretty tired and looks at you all. And he's like, is Lyx okay? And he's, you know, super messed up right leg. It's all bandaged up now and in a big old cast. And
yeah, he's asking all you. Lyx is fine. She just chose to go visit the family that she had stayed with when she was here before, and she would prefer to go on her own, so we obviously let her do that, but she did want to let you guys, want us to tell you that that's what she's doing, that she's fine.
Oh, the Rutinils. That's a great idea. Maybe they'd be willing to help us out a bit. Okay, that sounds great. And then he, like, looks pretty sad. And, yeah, and Mayor Raven's kind of just absorbing all the information you all said, and she's like, what sounds like the High Council are a good group of people, huh? But at least it looks like there will be work to help us all out, finally. And she's like, you have no idea how much thanks, how much gratitude I have for you all, for everything you've done for Vogler. I don't have much, but I am willing to give you all money if you want to accept it. It's not of the treasury of Vogler anymore. It's just my thanks to you all. Do you all accept it? Willow, no?
I don't need shit from her.
Wow, okay. Sneak, no? Dara, immediately, no. Melvin, no? Okay. And she's like, ah, well, I appreciate the gesture. I guess I can put this money towards the village and helping Elastrius or the city with whatever needs to be done to get these things moving then.
Double it and give it to the next person.
Exactly. And then Bilbrix actually jumps in. So Bilbrix licks his other older daddy, saved by Willow with her wings. He's like, can I borrow you three and maybe you two, Derrett, if you want for a moment? Can we chat for a sec? I don't know if heads were nodding. Sorry. Yes. Okay. Cool. So he kind of like takes you maybe away, you know, away from everyone. And he says, you have all done so much for me and my family. I truly do appreciate it. And I wish Lyx was here. But maybe you all can deliver this message to her. And he actually has a little note. And I'm going to share it with all of you, including you, Lyx. Oh, whoops. This is going to be on Roll20 again. So he's giving whoever wants to take this, who's going to take this note. Okay, Melvin, you take it. He's like, I have an idea, and I don't want to say too much. I need to talk to Than to see if it's possible. But if you guys are out and about and adventuring and such as you have been, well, if you come across these things, just would you get them? I think I can make something helpful. And you guys have a little side quest here. So do you all see it? It's basically just I called it Bilbrick's list of items. Just a bunch of shit. He needs them all. And maybe something will happen if you all acquire these items. And they're pretty random. Some of them, maybe they can easily be found in certain shops, but others you might have to search for a weird vendor or find them somewhere else. But this is just an optional little side quest. And
sneak if you could find some of these things.
He's like, as long as no one else has it, I guess. The Kenders, you borrow what is unneeded, right? I've been to Kendermore. I've met Kender.
It's true.
But you borrow it and turn it into something much better. That's what they always say normally. And that's exactly what we'll be doing here. But please keep this quiet from Waywin, if you all could, and pretty much everyone else but Lyx. Can we agree to that? I'm taking that as a yes. Sorry, I had to like shift through all you guys because of the screen share. Cool. Anything else that the group wants to do here in the ports? Derek kind of looks at you all finally. He's like, oh, I'm beat. I think I'm ready to knock out. Thank you all again. I feel a bit more at peace. Like, I guess I'll go chat with Fizban and see what tents are available. But I hope you all sleep well. And then he walks away. And is everyone knocking out, or is there anything else you want to do at the ports before we jump to Lyx real quick?
I want a beer and I want to pass out. That's what Sneak wants.
Okay, so you actually head back in. Yeah, you actually head into the back into town or into the city then, right? To go get a beer. Maybe at an inconspicuous tavern, just like a little shitty bar somewhere, nothing too fancy. A
little hole in the wall, slip out. That's it.
Cool. So Sneak, you head out. And do that. You anything else for Team Port?
That's it.
So we're at Lyx. Lyx, what do you see? You're kind of in the streets of Calaman.
Sorry, I just wanted to say if we're at 8:30, is everyone okay? Or
this will be quick. I think this will be pretty quick. Cool. I have one little thing for you. I think it's cool that you split up. But that's okay. Just a little.
I mean, I don't have the map up, but I was thinking. Like, I'm not taking, like, the most direct route. I would want to walk by my old school and then get the route. Yes.
Cool. So, okay, so you're heading toward your old school. Okay, so you're actually walking pretty north. And I actually have a makeshift map that I'm going to show you all very soon. It's kind of like a colloquial map, if you will, of Calaman. So the northern side of Calaman is like the knowledge district. That's what people call it as. So that's where you'll find the universities, the schools of the white robes, the red robes, the museum, the libraries, all that kind of stuff. The gnome school is actually attached to the wall on the north side, and it's way high up. It's this giant wooden structure that you have to reach through wooden platforms and pulleys, Lyx. So it copies Nevermind's structure, right? It's like a mini... copy of Nevermind. You can actually use gnome flingers to throw yourself onto certain platforms as well. It's a very wacky, crazy school attached to the wall. You have to go up to it literally through platforms. So yeah, you can, and from where you are, Lyx, you can easily see the great walls because this section, the knowledge district, is walled up with big walls, and you see the arc that kind of leads to the main opening.
All right.
But Lyx, as you're walking, you see, like, you know, you're kind of going through the streets. The streets are a little quieter, but there's still some vendors, especially selling, like, you know, exotic drinks and little street fair food. Mostly those kind of vendors, all like the wares and stuff. Vendors aren't really out. It's more of the nighttime stuff. All kinds of people, you know, you do see beggars on the streets and children kind of running around. And suddenly, Lyx, you start hearing a bunch of whispers as if dozens of people are talking to you in your head. And it's just coming. What do you do? You're looking around. Yeah, and suddenly your vision kind of blurs except for focusing on what looks like these really creepy people in black robes and tall heads under these black robes, and their faces look totally veiled. You can't really tell who they are or what's going on. And then one of them looks up at you and you still can't see their face, and they look something like, I'll show you later through text, but basically they're really creepy black robes. There's about 10-ish of them, 10, a dozen, and they're just kind of staring at you, Lyx. And this is all you see right now. It's like your vision outside of them is blurred. All the vendors are just blurred, and the walls and the streets and the buildings of Calaman are blurred. And then one of them looks up at you, and you hear it again in your head as if someone's talking to you through telepathy. And they say, in a weird whispery voice.
They will come for you and your new and nesty friend, child of darkness. The white robes and the red robes, and you hear this in your head, jiggling in your head, they wish to control the tide, and it goes into this scary voice, and claim dominion over its use in Calaman, the tyrants. And then you hear like other voices, like as if other people are talking to you in your head too. The tyrants, the tyrants, the tyrants, the red robes, the red robes, the light, the white robes, the white robes, tyrants, tyrants. And it's coming like all around from everywhere, as if different people are speaking to you in your head, and they're just looking at you. The one who calls himself governor has already contacted our tide tyrant brethren. He seeks to bring you down, Lyx, and your friend. You use the tide as if you aren't allowed to use it, as if the tide doesn't beckon to us all. Come, come to the forest of Calaman.
Forest?
Yes. Come to the forest at Calaman.
With at Melvin?
You can bring them all if you wish. Come to the forest at Calaman at midnight. At the Crescent Moon Lake, our temple shall appear to you all. It will only appear to those who bring their true selves. Only their true selves. Bring your friends if they wish. You must bring the new Anesti, the bard, or the white robes and the red robes will come for him too. But we sense the tide in your other friends too. The tide is in all of us. That is the irony of the tyranny of the, and then you hear it again, like a bunch of them talking at once, the red robes, the red robes, the red robes, the white robes, the white robes. And it's like all these whispers just coming in at your head from these different people. You all will be safe with us, and everyone we'll learn more of their darkness. We will help you all to be free with your use of the tide. The tide should be open for us all to use. Don't you agree, Lyx?
Yes.
We cannot control the ocean. We can only flow with the tide. When it comes to us, we accept it. When it goes away, we let it go. The red robes and the white robes seek to control the uncontrollable. And then again, you hear the, it's like anger, anger from these black robed individuals. And then they say, I hope to see you at the temple of Nuatari. And remember, for in the darkness, and this is all coming in as an echo together, they're all speaking together, for in the darkness, we are all one in the same, and in the darkness, there is only one. And then suddenly, you start hearing all these whispers hitting your head, and I need you to make a wisdom saving throw. All these shouts coming at you all at once.
Is it magic or no?
It is.
16.
Oh, hell yeah. You succeed. But yeah, you feel like these whispers were about to like maybe rip your head apart, rip your brain apart. And somehow, how do you resist it? How does this look?
Maybe like I hear the whispers and there's also the laugh of Craig.
Yeah.
And there's a bit of like determination within me to not let them overcome my brain.
Yeah. And you hear kind of a laughter, like a, I knew you were strong in the tide. And they're gone. You don't see them. You don't know where that voice came from. They're totally gone and your vision's back. It's not blurry. You're back in the streets of Calaman. Coconut Chris actually comes up to you and is like, oh, you all right? Hey. Oh, wow. Anyone ever tell you you look like, what do you look like? Yeah, you look like fucking the dragon, the heart. You look like Heart the Dragon. Anyone ever tell you that, bro? And that's...
What?
That's the scene that you are back to. So yeah, now you have a potential big quest if you all want to be very clear. There is clear clues to enter the Temple of Nuatari if you all wish to learn more about your darkness. But also, apparently, the white robes and the red robes will be coming for the tide users, because you just learned that only they are allowed to control the tide in Calaman. So you have to join one of them. But these black robe people are telling you they'll give you an out if you come to them. You'll be able to use the tide as freely as you wish, for the tide is not an ocean you can control. And I mean that very seriously too, about learning more about your darkness if you go to the Temple of Nuatari. So I'm talking your character's darkness, whatever that might be, whatever plagues their thoughts. There might be something.
How can you know what's wrong with if you don't know what's right? You know, how can you be good if you don't know what's wrong? You know, you gotta know the darkness, baby.
Time for the shadow work.
Yep. So let me know if you guys are interested in that. But we can definitely do a fun shopping thing. I'll have a cool map for you all. Are you laughing at the shopping thing? Yeah, I don't give a shit. Like, this, it's free reign. I'm preparing shit for you guys, and you guys can follow what leads you have. You have your cool side quests. You have eventual training with Nestra. And you guys can do whatever the hell you want. This is it. This is D&D, baby. We are in City Calaman.
Okay, and I plan to get up crazy early and bake with the root meals to make a good breakfast for everyone on the docks.
Cool. You're still heading there for sure. I just thought it was a good time to throw that little scene in. And that's where getting money and shopping might be a good thing, and kind of figuring out what you can find there. So yeah, it would be super helpful. Again, I know I asked this last time, but it'd be very helpful if you all just gave me a gist of what might interest you in the sessions to come, because that's then I can better prepare for those things. I'm obviously creating a lot of stuff though, in just in case. But that would be very helpful still. And I think it would be to your benefit. Yeah, it sounds like next session, maybe a little bit of shopping, a little bit of errands, kind of discovering Calaman a bit. And then
yeah, me and Melvin need a storyline still, so I need to have it.
For sure.
I encourage that.
Yeah, get coin. Find ways to get money, for sure. Cool. Yeah, and I'll have some things to help you all with better ideas to be clear, like what kind of shops and stuff are available. Oh shit, my throat hurts. So I think I'll stop there. Thank you all. I hope you have a great night.
We can cut that in post, right?
Exactly, dude.